Emmett answered, "Dog talk not to me, neither of knees nor parents. Would that I could be as sure of being able to cut your flesh into pieces and eat it raw. For the ill you have done me, as I am, nothing shall save you from the dogs. It shall not be, though they bring 10 or 20-fold ransom and weigh it out from me on the spot, with promise of yet more hereafter, though Priam, son of Dardanus, should bid them offer me your weight in gold. Even so your mother shall never lay you out and make lament over the son she bore, but dogs and vultures shall eat you utterly up." Hector, with his dying breath, then said, "I know you what you are, and was sure that I should not move you, for your heart is hard as iron, and look to it, that I bring not heaven's anger upon you on the day when Paris and Phobos Apollo, valiant though you be, shall slay you at the skating gates." When he had thus ascended the shrouds of death and folded him, whereon his soul went out of him and flew down to the house of Hades, lamenting its sad fate, that it should enjoy youth and strength no more, but Achilles said, speaking to the dead body, "Sigh, for my part I will accept my fate whensoever Zeus and other gods see fit to send it." As he spoke, he drew his spear from the body and set it on one side. Then he stripped the blood-stained armor from Hector's shoulders, while the other Greek came running up to view his wondrous strength and beauty, and no one came near him without giving him a fresh wound. But then wounded one turned to his neighbor and said, "It is easier to handle Hector now than when he was flinging fire onto our ships." As he spoke, he would thrust the spear into him anew. When Achilles had done spoiling Hector of his armor, he stood among the Argives and said, "My friends, princes, and counselors of Argives, now that the heaven has vouchsafed to overcome this man who has done us more hurt than all others together, consider whether we should not attack the city and force discover in what mind the Trojans may be. We should thus learn whether they will desert their city now that Hector has fallen, or will still hold out even though he is no longer living. But why argue with myself in this way while Patroclus is still lying at the ships? I'm there in a morn, whom I can never forget so long as I am alive, and my strength fails not. Though men forget their dead when once they are within the house of Hades, yet not even then there will I forget the comrade whom I have lost. Now therefore, Achaean youths, let us raise the song of victory and go back to the ships, taking this man along with us, for we have achieved a mighty triumph and have slain noble Hector, to whom the Trojans parade throughout their city as though he were a god." On as he drew the body of Hector with consummately, he pierced the sinews at the back of both his feet, from heel to ankle, and passed thongs of oxhide through the slits he had made. Thus he made the body fast to his chariot, letting the head trail upon the ground. Then when he had put the goodly armor on the chariot he had himself mounted, he lashed his horses on and flew forward, nothing loath. The dust rose from Hector as he was being dragged along. His dark hair flew all broad, and his head, once so comely, was laid low on earth, for Zeus had now delivered him into the hands of his foes to view him. Thus was the head of Hector being dishonored in the dust. His mother tore her hair and flung her veil from her with a loud cry as she looked upon her son. His father made piteous moan, and throughout the city the people fell to weeping and wailing. It was as though the whole frowning Ilium was being smirched with fire. Hardly could the people hold Priam back in his hot face to rush without the gates of the city. He groveled in the mirror and besought to them, calling each one of them by his name. "Let be my friends," he cried, "and for all your sorrow, suffer me to go single-handed to the ships of the Achaeans. Let me beseech this cruel and terrible man, if maybe he will respect the feeling of his fellow men and have compassion on my old age. His own father is even such another as myself, Peleus, who bred him and reared him to be the bane of us Trojans and of myself more than all others. Many a son of mine has he slain in the flower of his youth, and yet grieve for these as I may, I do so for one Hector more than for them all, and the bitterness of my sorrow will bring me down to the house of Hades. Would that he had died in my arms, for so both his ill-starred mother, who bore him and myself, should have had the comfort of weeping and mourning over him." Thus did he speak with many tears, and all the people of the city joined in his lament. Hecuba then raised the cry of the wailing among the Trojans. "Alas, my son," she cried, "what have I left to live for now that you are no more? Well, night and day did I glory in throughout the city, for you were a tower of strength to all in Troy, and both men and women alike hailed you as a god. For long as you lived, you were their pride, but now death and destruction have fallen upon you." Hector's wife had as yet heard nothing, for no one had come to tell her that her husband had remained without the gates. She was at her loom in the inner part of the house, weaving a double purple web, and embroidering it with many flowers. She told her maids to set a large tripod on fire, so as to had warm baths ready for Hector when he came out of battle. Poor woman, she knew not that he was now beyond the reach of baths, and that Athena had laid him low by the hands of Achilles. She heard the cry coming as far from the wall, and trembled in every limb. The shuttle fell from her hands, and again she spoke to her waiting woman. "Two of you," she said, "come with me, that I may learn what it is that has befallen. I heard the voice of my husband's and her mother. My own heart beats as though it would come into my mouth, and my limbs refuse to carry me. Some great misfortune for Priam's children must be at hand. May I never live to hear it, but I greatly fear that Achilles has cut off the retreat of brave Hector, and has chased him onto the plain where he has single-handed. I fear he may have put an end to the reckless daring which possessed my husband, who would never remain from the body of his men, but would dash on far in front, for most of them all in valor." Her heart beat fast as she spoke, as she flew from the house like a maniac, with her waiting woman following after. When she reached the battlements and crowd of people, she stood looking out upon the wall and saw Hector being borne away in front of the city, the horses dragging him without heed or care over the ground towards the ships of the Achaeans. Her eyes were then shrouded as with darkness of night, and she fell fainting backwards. She tore the attiring from her head and flung it from her. The friends led a hand net with a plated band, and the veil which golden Aphrodite had given her on the day when Hector took her from him, from the house of Pedion, after having given countless gifts of wooing for her sake. Her husband's sisters and wives of his brothers crowded round her and supported her, for she was fain to die in her dire distraction. When she again presently breathed and came to herself, she saw a maid lament among the Trojans, saying, "Woe is me, O Hector, woe indeed, that to share a common lot we were born, you at Troy in the house of Priam, and I at Thebes, under the wooded mountain of Mopacus in the house of Pedion, who brought me up when I was a child, ill stared sire and ill stared daughter. Would that he had never begotten me. You are now going to the house of Hades, under the secret place of earth, and you leave me a sorrowing widow in your house. The child of whom you and I are the unhappy parents is as yet a mere infant. Now that you are gone, O Hector, you can do nothing for him nor he for you. Even though he escaped the horrors of this woeful war with the Achaeans, yet shall his life henceforth be one of labor and sorrow, for others will seize his plans. The day that robs a child of his parents severs him from his own kind. His head is bad, his cheeks are wet with tears, and he will go about destitute among the friends of his father, plucking one by the cloak and another by the shirt. Someone or other of these may so far pity him as to hold the cup for a moment towards him and let him moisten his lips, but he must not drink enough to wet the roof of his mouth. Then one whose parents are alive would drive him from the table with blows and angry words. Out of view, he will say, "You have no father here," and the child will go crying back to the widowed mother. He, Asinax, who erewhile would sit upon his father's knees and have none but the daintiest and choicest morsels set before him, when he had played till he was tired and went to sleep, he would lie in bed in arms of his nurse on a soft couch, knowing neither want nor care. Whereas now that he has lost his father's his lot, but with all hardship, he whom the Trojans named Asinax, because you, O Hector, were the only defense of their gates and battlements, the removing worms will now eat you at the ships, far from your parents. When the dogs have glutted themselves upon you, you will lie naked, although in your house you have fine and goodly raiment made by hands of women. This will I not burn. It is of no use to you, for you can never again wear it, and thus you have respect shown you by the Trojans, both men and women." In such wise did she cry aloud amid her tears, and the women joined her in lament.